Welcome to Nuclear Hotseat, the weekly international news magazine keeping you up to date on all things anti-nuclear. My name is Libby Halevi. I am the producer and host, as well as a survivor of the nuclear accident at Three Mile Island from just 1 mile away. So I know what can happen when the nuclear so-called experts get it wrong. This week, we go to the other side of the world to hear about radioactive gold, uranium issues in the gold mining industry of South Africa. We speak with Mariette Lefferink, who is CEO of the Federation for a Sustainable Environment, widely recognized as the most prominent of the environmental activist stakeholders in the mining industry. Think Africa is safe from the majority of nuclear issues because there are only 2 commercial reactors on the whole continent? Think again, and fasten your seatbelts for a truly bumpy and revelatory interview. We also introduce a new feature this week, Social Media Super Tricks, weekly tips on how to get the most out of your anti-nuclear online presence with Dave Parrish of Fuku Friday Happy Hour Hangout. This 2-month series starts today, and trust me, we need this information to up our game. Plus, there will be NUMNUTZ of the Week, activist shoutouts, and more nuclear information than Bernie Sanders has yet mentioned during his blazing campaign trail talks. But we're hoping, Bernie. We're hoping. All of that coming up in just a few moments. Today is Tuesday, July 21st, 2015, and here is the week's anti-nuclear news. 3 weeks of news to catch you up on. I'm going to do my best. Starting off in Japan, where the government joyfully announced that 7,000 residents from the Fukushima town of Naraha will be able to return home permanently in September. What they don't bother to say is that the people are being forced back into their homes because Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, baby, is pressing to lift evacuation orders by March of 2017 and cut off compensation to victims of the disaster by 2018. This would force tens of thousands of refugees to go back to their homes. In Naraha, the entire town was declared a no-entry zone after the Fukushima nuclear disaster began on March 11 of 2011, but the evacuation order will be lifted on September 15, despite the fact that radioactive cesium is still being found in the tap water of the town. The Vice Minister of Economy, Trade, and Industry, Yosuke Tagaki, said on July 16 that radioactive cesium amounts in the tap water are below the detectable level. However, last year in July, the Ministry of the Environment found up to 18,700 becquerels of radioactive cesium per kilogram of soil at the bottom of the reservoir at the Kido Dam in Naraha. And that's the source for the tap water. However, the vice minister said, "I think whether you think the water source is safe or not is a psychological issue." No, dude, it's not in the head. It's in the water. And they don't want it in their bodies. Pro-nuclear Prime Minister Abe says that the move is aimed at speeding up Fukushima's reconstruction. Others, however, believe that it is ass-covering and image-constructing in honor of the 2020 Radioactive Tokyo No-Olympics. That's what I'm calling them from now on, the No-Olympics. Meanwhile, as more than 20,000 people have been scrubbing radiation from the villages around Fukushima, dressed only in gloves, masks, and boots to protect their bodies, more than 2.5 million black plastic bags filled with contaminated soil, plants, and leaves wait at the sites or in one of nearly 800 quote-unquote temporary outdoor storage facilities that have been set up across the disaster zone. Is this what you would want to come home to? So what's going on at the disaster site? According to a document from TEPCO, Tokyo Electric Power Company, nuclear fuel burned through the bottom of the containment vessel under Fukushima Reactor Unit 1. According to Shunichi Suzuki, a Tokyo Electric Power Company official who spoke at the 2014 International Research Institute for Nuclear Decommissioning Symposium, leakage we observed indicates melt-through. This is a very big problem. Ya think? As for the situation at Fukushima Daiichi, scientists from Japan's National Institute of Radiological Sciences, Hirosaki University, and Peking University in May 2015 issued a paper that stated that last year plutonium levels 10 million times normal were in the water below Fukushima reactors. The plutonium hit the record high off the coast in 2014, and that this water has been transported relatively long distances, according to this source. The scientists added that every sample taken from rivers flowing into the Pacific had plutonium 239, 240, 241, and 242 from the facility. Further, nuclear waste is overflowing into the Pacific Ocean at Fukushima. Radioactive water from a drainage canal has been spilling into the Pacific due to heavy rains from an approaching typhoon. TEPCO suspects that the rain has washed away mud and soil that contains radioactive materials. And with the approach on July 16 of Tropical Storm Nanka, was expecting torrential rainfall, landslides, and flooding, as well as the possibility of tidal waves. All of this just 15 miles away from the town of Naraha. And it's supposed to have nothing to do with their safety. And more water problems at Fukushima Daiichi, with 7,000 tons of radioactive water at risk of leaking into the ground that has to be removed from underground tunnels and other locations at Fukushima Daiichi. I love how this article calls it tainted water. Tainted. No, it's radioactive. This water could be found in at least 16 locations at the facility, including cable tunnels under reactors 2 and 3. The highest level of radioactive substances contained per liter was more than 60 times higher than the provisional standards for water that TEPCO may discharge within the facility site. And still, Prime Minister Abe Baby wants those nuclear plants all over the country to restart. And to that end, he's had Tokyo Electric Power Company invite the world's top nuclear agency to review the safety of its Kashiwazaki Kariwa facility to win international backing to resume operations at the world's largest atomic power plant. So who did TEPCO invite in? The International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, the world's largest promoter of nuclear everything. That's like the fox inviting another fox into the henhouse to inspect the chickens. What have those boys been drinking? Wait, maybe it's
Nuclear hot seat,
none of the week. So what do you do if you've got all this buckwheat and there's not a single Jewish deli in sight to make kasha? Well, if you live in Kawauchi, Japan, only 15 minutes away from the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster site, until recently part of the evacuation zone and still highly suspect when it comes to radiation levels in that buckwheat, you listen to a request made by the Kawauchi Tourism Association and make it into beer. That's right, Fukushima low malt imitation beer made using buckwheat grown locally. Too bad it doesn't have alcohol in it, because if you're going to be radiated from the inside out, you might as well be drunk. And that's why Kawauchi Tourism Association and Fukushima Buckwheat Near Beer are this week's
Nuclear Hot Seat, NUMNUTZ of the Week.
And how can they claim that Fukushima buckwheat is safe when Fukushima rice from 2014 exceeded radiation standards? According to the prefecture, radioactive cesium at 170 to 220 becquerels per kilogram, at its worst more than double the 100 becquerels per kilogram that is Japan's legal standard, was harvested 45 kilometers off of the Daiichi site. The rice is said to be not distributed in the market, but maybe it's showing up in school lunches, mixed with other rice to bring the level of the whole kilogram down to a legal limit, or they'll just take it to USA, 12 times the radiation, USA, perfectly legal to sell here and not have to label. Tra-la, tra-lay. What's not making it into the media, except through social media, is that thousands of Japanese people have been demonstrating, marching through the streets against nuclear restarts, the loss of compensation to Fukushima refugees, and against the remilitarization of Japan. Prime Minister Abe's approval ratings have been falling, and it appears that his ability to bully the country into doing his will is slipping significantly. We'll keep you posted. Over to the U.S., where we're going to catch you up on what's been happening to our antique fleet of nuclear reactors with the nuclear hot seat duck and cover report. The Fort Calhoun nuclear station, 20 miles north of Omaha, was shut down on Monday, July 20th, because a water pump that helps with cooling began leaking. Back in 2011, Fort Calhoun was infamously surrounded by a flooding Missouri River and protected from Fukushima-style flooding only by an 8-foot inflatable berm that at one point deflated when a backhoe backed into it. The facility has been shut down for repairs for an extended period of time, but it looks like they're going to have to send it back to the shop for some more work. Other accidents at nukes in the last 2 weeks include, but are not limited to, Fitzpatrick in Oswego, New York, when maintenance workers on the roof opened what the NRC called, in their official report, multiple openings in the roof of the reactor building, and went on to say that these holes could have prevented fulfillment of a safety function. The site is still down and will continue to be so until the repairs can be completed. Both units at Surrey in Virginia and DC Cook 1 in Michigan are still at zero power. Columbia Generating Station, next to the Hanford site in Richland, Washington, is stuck at 64%. River Bend in Louisiana is down 18% on its power. Browns Ferry in Alabama is down 18%. And even Clinton in Illinois is down from full power. I wonder if that's a metaphor for the election. In Pennsylvania, an investigation by reporters from NBC 10 showed that there are 8 different nuclear power plants in and around the Delaware Valley in Pennsylvania. But if something goes wrong, evacuation plans are, in their words, limited. Actually, while there may be plans on paper for every nuclear plant around the country, in all honesty, they are all untenable. But kudos to an NBC station, mainstream media, for being willing to do this investigation and find out where, oh, where are the other stations around the country with a comparable investigation. And with all this evidence of aging, creaky, reeky, falling apart nuclear reactors all over the country, officials at Dominion Resources, Exelon, and Duke Energy, all of the major nuke operators, are all considering submitting license applications to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission that would extend the life of some facilities to 80 years. Now, these things are only designed to run for 40 and then be shut down because of embrittlement and other safety issues. But because the NRC, the very definition of a captured agency, never met a nuclear operator it didn't love, about three-quarters of the U.S. nuclear fleet has already applied for and received licenses allowing them to operate for 60 years. And based on a campaign that was started by the nuke industry 4 years ago, when I was first doing Nuclear Hot Seat, under the catchy title, Is There Life After 60? Apparently Dominion, Exelon, and Duke are all going for that additional 20. Think of a 40-year-old car. Would you want to see it running and trust it until it went another 40 years? That's what we're facing here. And that's this week's Nuclear Hot Seat Duck and Cover Report. Things are heating up in the probe into the settlement surrounding the San Onofre shutdown, as search warrants have reportedly been executed. This is about the deal that stuck ratepayers with a $3.3 billion bill, 70% of what it will cost to shut down the defunct San Onofre nuclear power plant in San Clemente. State agents have now executed search warrants at the San Francisco headquarters of the Public Utilities Commission, as well as the Rosemead headquarters of Southern California Edison. Critics charge that the groundwork for the deal was struck at a closed-door meeting in Poland 2 years ago. Yes, that's right, Poland, the country. You think they were maybe trying to hide something? The meeting involved Michael Peavy, who was then president of the PUC, and an unnamed top executive of Southern California Edison. According to Gene Stone of the group Residents Organized for a Safe Environment and a longtime San Onofre activist, Edison knew that they were going to make more money decommissioning than they were to keep making electricity. So they tried to get the public to pay for the steam generator debacle, which they messed up. Kinda like the producers. We're following this one closely. In Frederickstown, Pennsylvania, high levels of radiation have been found in a stream that feeds into a water treatment plant for water that ends up in Pittsburgh. Lab results showed levels of radium-226 and radium-228 that were at 60 times the EPA drinking water standard. That's 60 times. As one activist is quoted saying, there's something in here that's not supposed to be here. At the waste isolation pilot plant in Carlsbad, New Mexico, the underground repository for plutonium-contaminated nuclear weapons waste that has been shut down since an explosion released americium and plutonium into the environment on February 14 of 2014, officials are now touting a new fire-free zone as a reason to celebrate and increase the number of workers allowed underground from 75 to 98. Here's the problem. Yes, there was a fire at WIP, which is what the site is referred to. That took place on February 5th, but the release of radiation into the underground facility and beyond that into the environment took place as a separate incident on February 14th. And there was no fire involved there, though the heat underground did increase to 1,600 degrees Fahrenheit. A new fire room does nothing to mitigate from exposure to radiation. And indeed, there were 22 workers who at the time were exposed to radiation and later tested positive to internal contamination with radionuclides, none of whom have gotten a second opinion about what exactly was done to them. So this is just misdirection on the part of our government saying, see over here, fire room. Pay no attention to what happened to the deadly radionuclides and the mystery of what caused the release. Taking an international perspective, according to documents given to Norwegian officials by Russian authorities and published in Norwegian media, enormous quantities of decommissioned Russian nuclear reactors and radioactive waste were dumped into the Kara Sea in the Arctic Ocean, north of Siberia, over a course of decades. The catalog of waste dumped at sea by the Soviets, according to the documents seen by the Bologna Foundation, includes some 17,000 containers of radioactive waste, 19 ships containing radioactive waste, 14 nuclear reactors, including 5 that still contain spent nuclear fuel, 735 other pieces of radioactively contaminated heavy machinery, and the K-27 nuclear submarine with its 2, count them, 2 reactors loaded with nuclear fuel. In a continuation of the food fight between Taiwan and Japan, 24 Taiwanese firms have been found to have imported food products from 5 Japanese prefectures in violation of a ban that's been in effect since the 2011 Fukushima nuclear disaster began. Authorities beefed up, or tofu'd up, inspections after investigators found some Japanese food imports carrying Chinese labels different from the actual place of origin. This is a practice that is actually allowed in Japan, but is sensibly illegal in Taiwan. Japan has been so incensed at Taiwan's insistence on protecting its citizens from potentially irradiated food that they've taken the fight all the way up to the World Trade Organization, where it will get a hearing. A large fire erupted at the Paluel nuclear power plant in Normandy, France, on July 3rd. It took more than 6 hours before a team of 71 firefighters were able to fully extinguish it, No word of the cause of the fire or the damage to the facility. Also in France, Areva, that country's nuclear giant, has been aware since 2006 that the steel vessel that confines radioactivity of its flagship new generation reactor is faulty. Until now, it was thought that Areva had only recently become aware of, quote, very serious anomalies in its 9 billion euro, meaning $10 billion U.S., European pressurized reactor, the same model that has been sold to Britain. In April, it was revealed that excessive amounts of carbon in the steel in the top and bottom of the reactor's vessel could cause cracks, which could prove disastrous, since the vessel, which houses nuclear fuel, cannot be replaced during the lifespan of the reactor. Speaking of cracks in reactors, the Mühleberg nuclear reactor near Bern, Switzerland, experienced a scram on July 6th because of a problem with the water feed system. Mühleberg has been known to have a cracked nuclear reactor shroud since 1990, and without a flow of proper coolant at all times, the cracking could eventually lead to a nuclear meltdown. And both cesium-137 and 134 have been detected in seaweed on the west coast of British Columbia. What a world. We'll have today's featured interview in just a moment, but first, here's the wind-up and the pitch. Nuclear Hot Seat needs your donations to keep expanding and improving. If you hear a change in audio quality this week, it's because I finally broke down and bought a needed microphone. There are website host charges, WordPress help I have to hire to assist me, the service I use to post to podcasts and the internet, monthly marketing charges, and lots of little dings and dents that do add up. So if you like Nuclear Hot Seat, if it helps you understand the nuclear issue, maybe even helps you laugh at the ongoing numnutzery of the nuclear industry that wants you, yes you, to be confused, disempowered, and, well, maybe not dead, but we're headed that way. So consider giving even a small donation to help us out so we can get the word out. Go to nuclearhotseat.com, scroll down, and click on the big red donate button. Whatever you can do, know that your assistance goes a long way to help to keep me in good heart, and is gratefully appreciated. One of the most fascinating, eye-opening presentations I attended at the World Uranium Symposium in Quebec City earlier this year concerned uranium mining in South Africa and was delivered by today's guest. Mariette Lefferink is the CEO of the Federation for a Sustainable Environment, widely recognized as the most prominent of the environmental activist stakeholders in the mining industry. Mariette has twice been named South Africa's Environmentalist of the Year and has received awards, multiple seats on the boards of environmental groups, and has published in dozens of international and national academic papers. She provides a stunning overview of the radiation issues faced in South Africa, many of which will be familiar to any of us who work against nuclear around the globe, and one of which, concerning gold, was a real revelation. Mariette Lefferink, welcome to Nuclear Hot Seat.
Thank you.
What is your background, and what brought you to working on uranium mining issues?
I have a legal background, and I have been involved in a campaign against, at the time, the largest oil company in the world, Royal Dutch Shell Group. They wanted to build two highway petrol stations opposite my home, and I think my interest was narrow self-interest, and as a result, it was a nine-year campaign. I opposed their application. At first, I was assisted by communities, but what happens often is objectors fatigue developed, and in the end, I was the only one. The Royal Dutch Shell Group, at that stage, it was Sir Mark Moody Stewart, who at that time was the chairperson of Royal Dutch Shell Group, or the CEO. They then proposed that they would offer me, or they would want to make a proposal. Proposal turned out to be some significant benefits to myself, but I could not accept it. I then stated that it constituted a bribe. It contravened our National Environmental Management Act. And I stated that since I would be the only beneficiary, it would not be ethical for me to accept. At the same time, I was asked to speak at a preamble to the World Summit for Sustainable Development, which was held in Sandton in 2002, and I had to deliver a paper on my experience with Royal Dutch Shell Group. The night before I was to deliver my paper, the Shell personnel came to my house and they stated that they are withdrawing their entire application because they are sensitive to the concerns of the communities. They did honor their promise, but I still delivered my paper. It, of course, incurred significant wasted costs for Shell because they had bought out 23 properties. When I delivered my paper at the World Summit for Sustainable Development, it was very well received by the news media, and I was often featured in cartoons or even on front pages because I think it was sensational that one old woman could be successful against the, at that stage, the largest oil company in the world. And I think it gave me a false sense of grandiosity. I felt I was important. And it also made me realize that one single person can make a difference. It was after that campaign that I was approached by the 53 landowners of one of the richest gold and uranium mines in the world. And that mine was owned at the time by Goldfields. And they asked if I could assist them because their land could not, no longer be farmed because of the mining waste and also the dewatering of the underground groundwater, and I agreed to that, and that was how I started with regards to my advocacy, my lobbying, my whistleblowing in the gold mining industry.
That's an extraordinary story. I love it. What is your current position? What are you doing now in the country, and how long have you been focused on the uranium mining and gold mining aspect?
I started with gold and uranium mining in approximately 2003. I first focused on the gold mining industry, but as I developed an insight into the gold mining industry, as I read more of the academic peer-reviewed papers, the government reports, I realized that the gold ore co-occurs with uranium and that the tailings dams, that is the waste from gold mines, contain more than 600,000 tons of uranium. What is of a specific interest is the fact that the gold tailings often contain higher uranium grades than genuine uranium tailings. I also, because of the information contained in hundreds of peer-reviewed academic reports and government reports, realized that there are significant issues with regards to the uranium. Because of significant dust fallout, communities are often inhaling and ingesting uriniferous dust, that is dust containing uranium, and that has been classified by the National Nuclear Regulator. It is the organ of state in South Africa that is mandated to protect the public property and the environment against nuclear damage. Incidentally, mine tailings dams, that is the gold tailings dams, are classified as nuclear installations because of the uriniferous waste that it contains.
That is an astonishing statement, that because of the amount of uranium that is released in the gold mining process and put into the immediate environment, that it is classified as, what was the phrase you used?
Nuclear installation, similar to, for example, a nuclear plant or an enrichment facility.
Is this just in this one area in Africa, or is there always a connection, do you know, between gold mining and uranium being found in the same area?
It would not be similar in other areas. There might be areas that are also similar, but our gold ore co-occurs with uranium. So in the process of extracting the gold, you also have gold as a byproduct. South Africa used to export its uranium. We produced more than 73,000 tons of uranium between 1953 and 1995. We also supplied the Manhattan Project with uranium. But since then, because of the falling price in uranium, because of the Fukushima and Chernobyl incidences, there is no longer such an appetite for uranium in South Africa, and therefore the uranium is deposited with the gold waste on these tailings dams. There are more than 270 of these tailings dams, and there are more than 1.6 million persons living adjacent or on top of these uriniferous tailings dams.
As regards the people who are living in this environment, what has been the impact on their lives?
They are affected in two ways, both groundwater and surface water pollution, and also air pollution. That is the dust fallout. I may mention just within one region in the West Rand and Far West Rand goldfields, 50 tons of uranium into the groundwater annually. And that is because the tailings dams had been historically placed on unlined soil or often on dolomite, which is a porous rock, which allows for the percolation of metals, including uranium, in groundwater. Besides that, these tailings dams are significant sources of dust fallout. According to the West Rand District Municipality's Environmental Management Framework, 42.24 tons of dust enter the residential areas per day. The dust, because of the uriniferous nature of the dust, is the principal pathway of radioactive contamination. I also wish to mention that for us, the main concern of uranium is not only the radioactivity, but the chemical toxicity of uranium, which results in nephrotoxicity, that is chronic kidney disease and kidney failure, impairment of cognitive functions. It can also result in endocrine disrupting compounds and transgenerational impacts. So communities are exposed to all of these risks and hazards.
This is stunning information, because the impression, certainly among the activists who I know, is that, well, Africa only has two nuclear reactors in South Africa, so really the majority of the country and the continent are not really impacted by nuclear, which of course was completely contradicted when I went to the World Uranium Symposium and I learned about the mining issues around that continent. What, if any, remediation has been attempted in these areas around the mines? It doesn't sound like it's been very successful, but has there been any success or any lessening of the impact at all?
No. Notwithstanding the fact that there are hundreds of peer-reviewed academic reports and government reports, these findings and recommendations are not implemented, and there is a systemic failure on the part of the responsible regulators to enforce contraventions of our environmental legislation. The result is that in certain areas, such as the Bonnefontein Spruit, which flows into the Vaal River, a national water resource, and which also supplies water to 450,000 people in Potchefstroom. In that river system alone, it was found that the sediment in the river contained significant elevated levels of cadmium, cobalt, copper, zinc, arsenic, and uranium, with the main contaminants being uranium and cadmium. And these sediments are not permanently adsorbed in the sediment. Plausible environmental conditions such as acid rain, acid mine drainage, which is currently happening in South Africa, as well as turbulence caused by cattle, the drying out of the sediment and a sudden influx of water can cause the mobilization and solubilization of the metals, including uranium, into the drinking water. It was found by a researcher at the Northwest University in South Africa that the cattle that drink from the Bonnefontein Spruit, the uranium in their kidneys are 4,350 times higher than the uranium in cattle that do not drink from the river system.
Oh, my God.
So it impacts not only on dust and on water, but it impacts also on cattle, on crops, as well as fish, eggs, meat, milk, and that, of course, has a far-reaching risk or hazard not only to communities living adjacent to mine dumps, but also to other communities. It has been recommended that these 36 hotspots in this specific river, the Bonnefontein Spruit, should be remediated with urgency. Well, that was done in 2009. To date, the situation is exacerbated. We now have acid mine water flowing into river systems. Acid mine water also contains radionuclides. We also find that communities are now being located in low-cost housing on top of or adjacent to these uriniferous tailings dams. It has been estimated by our provincial government that there are 380 radioactive mine residue areas where people are now living. So it is not just inhalation and ingestion of uriniferous dust. It is the deposition of the dust on crops. It is the stay on radioactive land, which of course is the inhalation of radon, and it's widely accepted that radon causes lung cancer. Most of these communities are poor, and because they are poor, they often have shacks, and the shacks do not have concrete foundations, so there is a direct exposure to the inhalation of radon. Besides that, they also use contaminated water, acid mine water, for spiritual rituals, that is for baptisms, for traditional medicine. They use the sediment as well as the water for a certain spiritual cures. They also eat the contaminated sediment. It is a very common practice in South Africa amongst the black communities. It is a practice called geophagia or pika, where they eat this contaminated sediment and also sell it at certain taxi ranks. Then they are also, of course, exposed, besides the spiritual rituals, it's also the drinking of acidic water, the irrigation of crops with the water, and also the watering of cattle. It's also used for recreational purposes. Often we see young children swim in dams that have been classified as radioactive hotspots.
This is nuclear genocide happening on the ground. It doesn't take a bomb going off. It just takes the ongoing, relentless, and inescapable exposure to, it sounds like, ever-increasing levels of radioactivity.
Yes, I may just mention, it is not that our government officials are unacquainted with this. Often these reports that contain these findings are governmental reports. Unfortunately, it is not implemented. So these reports exist in vain if the findings and recommendations are not being implemented.
The work that you do, are you with an organization? Are you doing this on your own? And what is the approach that you are taking to the government and these regulatory bodies?
I have formed an organization called the Federation for a Sustainable Environment with other conservancies, with other civil society groups, also with other NGOs, both national and also international. We have them as our partners, and we have concentrated specifically on the realization of Section 24 of the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa, which is the right to an environment that is not harmful to health and well-being. And our mission and vision are specifically focused on addressing the concerns and the impacts on vulnerable communities, disempowered communities, disadvantaged communities, and marginalized communities that live in or close to mining companies and also work in mining companies. So this organization has been recognized by the news media as one of the most prominent NGOs in the mining sector in South Africa. And one of my co-directors and myself, and I hope I may say this without impeachment or forfeiture of modesty, have been recognized as one of us two of the 100 most influential people in mining in Africa. We have also the FSE, that is the Federation for a Sustainable Environment, has been the most principal and vocal activist regarding the acid mine drainage in South Africa. acid mine drainage has been recognized as being the most costly social, economic, and environmental impact. And all the mining basins in South Africa are now either flooded or flooding with acid mine drainage. And the first basin where the acid mine water started to decant into the river systems and receptor dams and into wetlands have had devastating consequences. If I may just mention one of the receptor dams, such as the Robinson Lake, which used to be a recreational dam, when acid mine drainage decanted into the Robinson Dam in 2002, it resulted in a recreational dam becoming a declared radiation area with uranium levels at 16 milligrams per liter, which is 40,000 times above uranium in natural water. So this is the consequence of the acid mine water. I think I may also just here interpose every statement that I make. Your listeners may call me to account because I borrowed all these statements with hyper-scrupulous attention to context and content from peer-reviewed academic reports and government reports.
I don't think there's a single listener who is against nuclear who listens to this. I know we do have certain people who listen who are from the other side of the table, but I don't think any of us would dispute or contradict or come up against you because it's so clear the level of expertise that you come from. Let's shift now to some of the work that has been done that you have been involved in getting the word out internationally about what is happening with uranium mining through the World Uranium Symposium and other events. This is where I first met you earlier in the year in Quebec, and there was an attempt that was made to organize a conference on the impact of uranium mining in Niger, or Niger, as it is also pronounced. To give listeners an idea of some of what you can be up against in dealing with these issues in Africa, tell us what happened when the attempt was made to get that conference started.
Yes, I was not intimately involved in the organization, but I do know that because of political upheavals, the Boko Haram threat within Niger, it was decided to hold the conference in South Africa. Now, in South Africa, you may be aware that South Africa is embarking on a nuclear path. They have already entered into preliminary contracts to build a second nuclear plant. It is as if the emphasis, there is almost a psychological dependency, not only on coal mining in South Africa, dirty energy, but also on uranium mining. And there is the misapposition that uranium mining is a clean energy, but what is often not taken into consideration is the whole chain of nuclear energy. And definitely with uranium mining, it is not a clean energy, and it also causes significant waste, but also significant usage of water. So if we take into consideration the whole cycle, then uranium has significant impacts and hazards and risks. With regard to the conference in November, that is from the 16th to the 19th of November in Johannesburg, we will be inviting speakers from Europe, from America, from the rest of the world, as well as from Africa. One full day will be devoted to the issues of uranium mining in Niger to give the participants from or delegates from Niger the opportunity to debate this issue. And there will also be academic presentations from quite a number of South African academics, persons that have had years of experience in uranium, persons of impeccable credentials that will be presenting. We have, however, also invited one or two that will be pro-nuke in order to allow for robust debate to take place and basically to ripen our judgment that nuclear is definitely not the way to go.
Is there anything that we have not yet covered that you think is important for the listeners of Nuclear Hot Seat to know?
Yes, I wish to refer to a small community. It's an informal settlement. It's a shanty town. I think that is the word that may be used. There are 1,800 people living in this informal settlement. They have three working toilets and three working taps. They are very vulnerable. They have very high HIV and AIDS percentages and chronic and acute malnutrition. This community has been placed by a district municipality since 1997 on highly radioactive land. The regulatory limit in South Africa for radioactivity is 250 microsieverts per year. This community live on land that is since 1997 that contain 13.14 millisieverts per year. There's a significant difference between micro and millisieverts. The result is that some scientists have even stated that they live in the same radioactivity level as the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. We have been campaigning for that. We've had court cases in order to have the community relocated and to have the mining waste removed and the area rehabilitated. We have not been successful. And I invite the listeners to look on Google, on the internet, and Google the word Tudor Shaft informal settlement. It's possibly the most photographed and documented and researched community in the world, and notwithstanding all of this effort, the community continues to live on this land. We've exhausted all our internal and external remedies, and perhaps some of the listeners would like to write to our South African Human Rights Commission and our Office of the Public Protector in order to call for the relocation of this community and the rehabilitation of the land. I just thought I'll mention that it's an example of how there had been a failure on the part of our regulators to protect especially the vulnerable and the disadvantaged from the risks of radioactivity.
Thank you for sharing that, and we will provide a link to the listeners of Nuclear Hotseat. We literally span the world, with now 59 countries having been logged as having people downloading the show every week. So we have the possibility here to make a real international impact on this issue, because that's a horrifying situation. It's almost like they're studying to find out what the impact is as opposed to trying to do anything to help the people.
Yes, and may I also then just add that in South Africa there had been no epidemiological studies done. There had been no toxicological studies done in order to determine the teratogenetic, the estrogenetic, and the mutagenetic impacts of the radioactivity on the local communities. The studies that have been done are embargoed in universities. The problem, therefore, is that it is almost impossible to establish a causal link with regards to the mining waste and the high incidences of anecdotal evidences of cancer and other ailments. So I am heartened to also report to your listeners that the World Health Organization, that is IARC, the International Agency for the Prevention of Cancer, has now embarked on a pilot study which is looking at the hair of communities living on or adjacent to uriniferous waste to see if the hair had accumulated uranium. So this is in a very early stage, almost an embryonic stage, but it is very heartening to know that at least there will be now a start made with regards to an epidemiological study.
Well, it is clear, Mariette, that you are doing brilliant work, that you are networked literally internationally on this issue. You already have made impact, and you continue to make impact on the side of sanity and responsibility when it comes to the nuclear issue.
Thank you.
I want to thank you for being my guest this week on Nuclear Hotseat.
I thank you very much, too, and I also wish you great success with your splendid show, and thank you also to your listeners.
Mariette Lieferink of South Africa. We will have links to her organization, the Federation for a Sustainable Environment, and to the Nuclearization of Africa conference coming up in November. Both will be on the website, nuclearhotseat.com, under this episode, number 113. Our next guest is the irrepressible Dave Parrish of Operation Save the Earth. Dave hosts Fuku Friday Happy Hour Hangout, every Friday at 4 to 6 Pacific time to allow people the opportunity to just have a mental jam session on various nuclear issues. Of course, right now it's only open to those of you who can figure out Google Plus, which certainly limits the gene pool, but we're working on it. Dave is a genuine social media expert. It's what he does for a living. I know that we all need to up our social media game if we're going to keep growing the anti-nuclear movement. So I invited Dave to come up with a series of brief lessons about social media, steps we can take, why we need to take them. Nuclear Hot Seat will be running one of these every week for the next 2 months. So get out a pencil, take a few notes, and here's Dave with part one of Social Media Super Tricks.
Hey guys, it's Dave here from Operation Save the Earth, and I'm here to bring you part one of our eight-part series, Social Media Super Tricks that you can use to help win this fight for Fukushima. Now, the history of social media goes all the way back to the beginning of mankind's history. As soon as we learned how to write and draw, that became our social media, a way to continue telling the story. Now that we have technology, though, that way of telling stories instantaneously, globally, has exploded over the last 20 years. And I'm here to tell you, I've seen it all, from CompuServe and AOL to Facebook and Google Plus today. But don't believe me, check out the numbers. They sure don't lie. Right now, there's 1.2 billion monthly users on Facebook. Almost 730 million users daily. And did you know there's over 3 billion Google searches done every single day? That's about one search per person on the web daily. That's right, there's over 3 billion worldwide users on the web and almost 2 billion smartphone mobile users. With numbers like that, it's easy to see why social change is happening at such a rapid pace now. From the Arab Spring till today, hacktivism, clicktivism, whichever you want to call it, you can see the results happening live, instantaneously, globally. It'll pop up on your phone. Pretty neat, huh? So here's the deal. Whether you're a blogger, website owner, Facebook group user, Google Plus runner, it doesn't matter which social media platform you're on. If you're going to be on, be a producer. And if you're going to be a producer, put content out every single day. Because persistent and consistent leads the way. That's your super trick for this week, guys. We'll see you next time.
That was Dave Parrish of Operation Save the Earth. To learn more about Dave's work against nukes, I've got a link up on the website, nuclearhotseat.com, under this episode, number 213. Activist shout-outs. Speaking of social media, I lean on many of you who are diligent, if not relentless, about posting information about nukes on Facebook and elsewhere online. Specifically, this week I picked up on great work done by Erica Gray of the Virginia Sierra Club on the NRC's nuclear accident reports, Nelson Surgeon, who writes so movingly about the children of Fukushima, and who shares obscure articles I haven't accessed anywhere else. Iori Mochizuki, who relocated from Tokyo to Romania to get out of Japan's radiation, and who publishes Fukushima Diary, a steady source of information since the earliest days of Nuclear Hot Seat. And Hervé Courtois of Rainbow Warriors, researcher and voice of reason extraordinaire. And so many others. You know, we're all in this together. Metaquiasin is a word used by some Native American people to indicate we are all related. In truth, we are. And none of us can do this without all of us. So thanks to those of you whose work helps me understand the issues, get the facts, and share them with everyone else. And thanks to all of you who share this information on your social media sites and email. We are weaving the web of life, hopefully in time to save it. Here's today's final thought. In taking 2 weeks off to rest my nuclear-bruised brain, I came to a deeper understanding of how I need to up the visibility of this program, positioning this weekly piece of anti-nuclear weaponry to use what we've got and get it where it can do some more good. This presents a lot of challenges for me personally, but I can't not do it. So here goes. One of my first targets for increased visibility is LA Weekly, an arts and entertainment newspaper that's an institution in Southern California. Right now, LA Weekly is asking for nominations for its big, honking Best of LA edition in September. This issue is a huge deal and guarantees high visibility for those that win. I'm nominating Nuclear Hot Seat as Best Podcast, and I need your votes to help me make the cut to get on the ballot. The podcast with the most votes at this point gets to the next level, so here's what you can do. If you are in Southern California, go to laweekly.com and click on the box in the banner that says, Vote in the Best of LA Readers Poll. That may have shifted location, so just search on the site and I know you'll find it. After that, follow the prompts to nominate Nuclear Hot Seat. For those of you who are not in Southern California, especially those of you who responded to my Facebook call for nominations and were frustrated at not being able to vote, today I spoke with the managing editor of the newspaper about the problem. She's alerting their IT department to this WTF, and I'll have further information for you next time as to whether and how you'll be able to vote. This is especially pertinent for those of you who are outside the continental United States. For those of you who wasted time in a premature attempt to support me, I apologize for the time loss. Thank you for telling me about it, and hopefully it won't stop you from going back to the source once we figure out how to do it. As for the rest of this visibility campaign, there's more a-coming, so stay tuned. This has been Nuclear Hot Seat for Tuesday, July 21st, 2015. Material from this week's program has been researched and compiled from ENENews.com, Japan's National Institute of Radiological Sciences, Hirosaki University, Peking University, NHK Japan, Times Mainichi, Greenpeace, Asia1.com, NeonNettle.com, Fukushima Diary, and our friend Iori Mochizuki, Rainbow Warriors, Omaha.com, NBCPhiladelphia.com, UtilityDrive.com, CBSLocal.com, WTAE.com, KTUU, Alaska Dispatch News, DailyMail.co.uk, CurrentArgus.com, ReviewJournal.com, FuelFix.com, Pew Research Center, Gene Hedl of Eon 3 on YouTube, TheGuardian.com, Telegraph.co.uk, Mining Awareness, SputnikNews.com, LeFigaro, Bologna.org, SCMP.com, Nuclear-News.net, TheGuardian.com, AJWAsahi.com, Silogs.com, Tokyo Electric Power Company, the well-paid but morally bankrupt copy drones at WorldNuclearNews.com, and the big-hearted, karmically correct members of the Nuclear Hot Seat Facebook community, which you are all invited to join. Theme music written by me, sung by Marilee Weaver. Nuclear Hot Seat is syndicated by UCY.TV, where in May of 2015, the show was downloaded from 58 countries on 6 continents. It's also available on iTunes under podcasts, and our archive is available on the website, nuclearhotseat.com, or iTunes. Our YouTube channel carries the show under Nuclear Hot Seat Videos, thanks to Joni Ray. Nuclear Hot Seat is the activist voice on nuclear issues, so if you have a story lead, a hot tip, or a suggestion of someone to interview, send an email to info@nuclearhotseat.com. We are copyright 2015, Libby Halevi and Hardestry Communications. All rights reserved, but fair use allowed as long as proper attribution is provided. This is Libby Halevi of Hardestry Communications, a comic journalist embedded in the nuclear issue, reminding you that in 2016 we hit the 5th anniversary of Fukushima and the 30th anniversary of Chernobyl, so let's start making our activist plans now. Consider this your nuclear wake-up call. Now don't go back to sleep, because we are all in the nuclear hot seat.
Nuclear hot seat, what are those people thinking?
Nuclear hot seat,
what have those boys been drinking?
Nuclear hot seat,
the corium is sinking. Our time to act is shrinking, but our activists are linking. Nuclear hot seat, it's the bomb.